So let's get started. Now, before Adolf Hitler came to power, the Jewish community lived a perfectly normal life among the rest of the German population. My mother was born in the northern part of Germany in a small town called Mielen. They had a large farm. They had horses, cows, chickens, a lot of land. Now, Adolf Hitler came to power in 1933. He never hid his disdain for the Jewish minority, even though there were less than 1% of the German population. The majority of Germans adored him. There were huge rallies in his honor. By 1935, the German parliament passed the Nuremberg Laws. Now, the purpose of the Nuremberg Laws was to separate us minority Jews from the rest of the German population. I'm only going to touch a few that affected my life. I was born in Stuttgart. That's the southern end of Germany. It was a big city. But I lived much further south in a small town called Kirchheim unter Teck. In Kirchheim, there were just a couple of dozen Jewish families. So all of my friends were non-Jews. Now, the first Nuremberg Law that touched my life was that no non-Jew was allowed to continue working in a Jewish home. We had a live-in. She'd been with us since I was born. Her name was Sophie. She and I shared a bedroom, ate a lot of meals together. In short, she was my constant companion. And when she was forced to leave our house, it was my first heartbreak. Another law, no non-Jew was allowed to shop in a Jewish store. And I remember curled up on the windowsill in front of our large display window, watching two members of the Nazi party in full uniform with rifles slung over their shoulders, marching back and forth in front of our front door, making sure no customers entered. Of course, it was the end of Dad's business. The most traumatic Nuremberg Law for me was the one that no Jewish child was allowed to continue attending public school. And I remember I was still in first grade. One day after class, the teacher calls me to her desk and in a firm voice says, "Don't return to school because you're Jewish." Now, I was devastated, but I was the only Jewish child in that class. For that matter, the only Jewish child in the entire school, so the only one affected. I wandered out into the schoolyard, and all the friends I'd walked to school with that morning had left without me. The only ones left, just a few young German boys who followed me home, taunting me all the way. My friends and I had a little routine. In the morning, we would meet in front of our house, walk to school together, meet in the schoolyard, walk home together, and then we'd go into our houses, change into play clothes, and go out and play until dinner time. That was my daily routine. But that morning, they had left without me. But I did have a very best friend. Her name was Marianne. She waited for me that awful day. She walked home with me, tried to comfort me, but I never saw her again. And I finally gathered my courage, and I asked Mom, what happened to her? Why did she stop playing with me? Mom told me when her dad came home from work and discovered that she had tried to stay friends with me, he took off his belt and he beat her, and he made her promise never to play with me again, and she never did. Of course, my life became very lonely after that. But much, much, much worse was to happen to the German Jewish community. That's why we're here today, November the 9th. 1938, 75, I can't believe it, 75 years ago today, Kristallnacht in German, the night of the broken glass in English. That night, we Jews lost all of our civil rights and liberties. 1,000 synagogues were burned to the ground. Old Jewish men in their 80s and 90s were actually dragged from their beds, dumped into lorries, and taken to concentration camps. Jewish shops were broken into. Oh yeah, the police were there. The fire brigade was there. The purpose of the fire brigade was in case a non-Jewish store burned by mistake. The purpose of the police was to keep the Jewish owner from going into his store to try to rescue some of his merchandise. So what happened was that the German people, the average German person, just broke the windows, broke down the doors, and helped themselves to merchandise. That's what happened. And I think it's pretty safe for me to say that after Kristallnacht, there wasn't a Jew in Germany who didn't want to get out. Our problem was where to go. What country would help us? Now, my dad, who can trace his roots all the way back to the 15th century in Germany, had in his possession his grandmother's Bible. On the back pages of the Bible were names and addresses of family members that had emigrated from Germany throughout the years. And he wrote to every one of them. And he received one response from a very, very distant cousin. His name was Henry Katz, right here from America, lived in Philly. And he wrote to my father, he would help us come to the US. One day, while my parents were once again discussing their dilemma and what to do, Dad gets a phone call from a former classmate. He now owned a travel agency, and he said to him, I have space for one person on a ship. It's going to Cuba. Somebody had just passed away. Now, you're not the next person on my list, but for old time's sake, I want to give you this chance to get out of Germany. Now, as much as Dad wanted to get out of Germany, he wasn't that keen about leaving Mom and me behind. But my mother, in her wisdom, insisted this unexpected opportunity, take it and go. And he did, but before he left Germany, he had to sell our home. Now, years later, he told me, of course there was someone in Kirchheim perfectly willing to purchase our house, but the sale never went through. Why? The head of the Gestapo in Kirchheim also wanted our house. One day, he was called into Gestapo headquarters, and he was asked to sign some papers. He read them through, and he realized that he was really giving our house away for a very nominal fee. And he started to protest, and they laughed at him. And he said, don't sign. But of course, the papers you need to get out of Germany, we're not going to sign. Well, naturally, he signed, and he left. Now, Mom and I were homeless. So we moved to Stuttgart, and we lived in, here you'd call it, a boarding home. Mom and Dad had already gotten tickets on another ship, which was also going to Cuba. It was going to leave June the 1st, 1939. One day, Mom gets a phone call from her travel agent, and he says to her, you know, there's so many German Jews going to Cuba. We set up this huge luxurious liner. It's going to hold 1,000 people. It has 8 decks. It's leaving May 13th. Do you want to change your reservations? And Mom immediately said, yes. Just for the record, the ship, that was supposed to leave June the 1st never left Germany. Therefore, May 13th, 1939, which happened to be a Saturday, we boarded the ship, the St. Louis, in Hamburg, Germany. There were 937 passengers, approximately 400 women, and around 200 kids. Every passenger had in his possession a legal landing certificate. This was signed by Cuba's Minister of Immigration. This was the legal right for us to enter Cuba. Now, of course, we all had our passports. In the meantime, the German government was making it more and more difficult for Jews in Germany, and one decree after another was passed. One decree that was passed was that suddenly every Jewish female had a middle name, and her name was Sarah. And every Jewish male had a middle name, and that was Israel. This is a bit out of order, but just very, very briefly. After Dad left, Mom became very nervous. And she wanted to make sure, so she told me years later, that I was not going to be stuck in Germany. So on her own, she got me the proper documents. In addition, she got me transportation on the children's transport. Now, you kids might not know what a children's transport is, but they were German Jews at that point were getting very desperate as what would happen to their children. So they put them on trains, some as young as 4 years of age. This is without the parents. And those kids went to England, and then strangers would take care of them. There was a transport to Holland. Now, Mom got me one on Holland. Years later, I said to her, "Why did you want to send me to Holland, not England?" And she said, "The transports to England were totally filled. She couldn't get me there. So she put me on another transport to Holland. Luckily, I didn't have to use them." This is the ship, the St. Louis. Notice the little boats on the side. I'll talk about those a little bit later. This is Mom and I on the deck. Now, for a kid, there was nothing not to like. I mean, there were 8 decks to explore. There's a big toy room, all kinds of toys and games and dolls and books. Swimming pool, as small as swimming pool for kids. It was fun. Our captain, Gustav Schroeder. Now, you kids know, all good stories have heroes, right? This was my hero, the captain, the German captain. And interestingly enough, he was the shortest captain in the German Navy. He was 5'4", and he was young. And he had a young wife and 2 little girls in Germany. The day we arrived in Cuba, I'll always remember, I was very excited. Mom had told me we were going to Cuba to be with my father, and I was always a daddy's girl, so I couldn't wait to be with my dad. We arrived very early in the morning, the ship, around 5 a.m. And I remember we had a very early breakfast in the ship's dining room when the loudspeaker beckoned us on deck. And as we looked overboard, there was my dad. He was in his tiny little rowboat. He was standing up, waving up at us with a big smile on his face. And I bet you my smile was just as big. Years later, I asked him, "How'd you get here so fast? The ship just arrived." He told me he had been so anxious to be with his little family that he stood vigil on the shore in Havana throughout the entire night. And the moment that the ship docked, he paid a Cuban to row him as close to the ship as they legally permitted him. Then, every day, I said to my mother, "When are we getting off the ship? When are we finally going to get off?" And her answer was always the same: "Tomorrow." Now, to give you some background so you understand what is she talking about, even though we had purchased the legal landing certificates, the Cuban government would not allow us into Cuba. They wouldn't let us enter. Now, to complicate this a little bit further, to come to America from Germany in 1939, there was a quota. 27,500, roughly, were allowed, that's all Germans, of course, to come from Germany to America. Now, my parents and everyone on the ship had quota numbers, and they all had low quota numbers, because frankly, in 1939, the Germans were quite content under their new leader and weren't really anxious to leave. In our particular case, we could have come to America 2 months later. Now, my hero, the captain, was getting cablegrams from the German government to bring the ship back. And I meant to mention, to me it's important, that I know positively that there were two ships following the St. Louis, and I think there were three. On the other ships were German Jews that had purchased the same legal landing certificates we did on the St. Louis. The difference was that the captain of the other ships, when they saw what was happening to us on the St. Louis, they turned their ships around and headed directly back to Germany. As an adult, I researched what happened to these people. I could have been on one of those ships. And I discovered when they got back to Germany, the German government wouldn't let them into Germany. They said they had lost their citizenship. And all of them were taken to concentration camps, which of course would have been my fate if Gustav Schroeder had listened to the German government, who were now demanding in cablegrams bring the ship back to Germany, which he did not do. Instead, he began to send cablegrams to the president of this country, and he never responded, just didn't respond. Now, this really became worldwide news. Now, kids, I want you to understand one thing. Remember this. No, what was missing? No computers, no televisions, no cell phones. Most of the people got their information through the radio and the newspapers. Now, you remember I showed you earlier, you saw the ship, the St. Louis, and you saw little boats around it? Those were newspaper reporters from all around the world taking the stories of different passengers. And on a personal note, my aunt, many years later, mom's younger sister, Lisa, told me, she was still in Germany at that time, that one of the decrees passed back at that point was no Jews were allowed to go into the movies in Germany. But she told me that she snuck into the movies because she'd heard something happened to the St. Louis. She knew we were on it, and she was concerned. So she told me, now, in the movie houses then, there were newsreels, and then, of course, your feature film. So she saw the newsreel, and she saw us, she said, on the ship. And it was, and she said it herself, wonderful propaganda for the German government. And she said, they said, here we let them go, we allowed them to leave Germany, but it looks like nobody in the world wants them, but we are going to take them back. Of course, they didn't add that it would be to concentration camps. And that's the story that she got from going to a German movie house. One day, I'm playing on deck, and I feel the lurching of the ship, and I realized we're moving. So I panic, and I rush into my mother's cabin, only to see her sobbing uncontrollably on her cot. So I wander up on deck, and I see adults, men and women, with the tears streaming down their faces. I didn't know much. I did know we're going somewhere. I did know my dad was in Cuba, not with us. I had no idea where we were going. I would have been even more scared if I'd realized the adults had no idea where we were going. For that matter, neither did the captain. We passed the Miami coastline so close that every passenger aboard the St. Louis could easily see the shimmering lights of Miami Beach. That's how close we were. One final cablegram, and it's all documented, was sent by Gustav Schroeder to the President of the U.S., pleading with him to allow the 200 kids sanctuary in this country. He never responded. Well, he responded this way. Coming directly from Miami Beach was a U.S. Coast Guard cutter. I remember waving at the captain. And I thought, this guy's here to help us. What did I know? The reality was, he wanted us out of, that is, the president wanted us out of U.S. waters as quickly as possible. So Gustav Schroeder began to circle the Atlantic. It gave a Mr. Trooper, he was the head of the European Jewish Joint Distribution Committee, which helped, it's an organization that helps Jews in distress. He gave him the opportunity to help us, which he did. He was able to get four countries to take us in. And those countries were England, Holland, Belgium, and France. And of course, the whole tragedy about the St. Louis was that, unfortunately, when the Germans went into Holland, Belgium, and France, too many, not all, but too many of those passengers were recaptured. Now, of course, those that went to England, 245, they were saved. Mom and I, we went to Holland. And there were 189 Jews from the ship that went to Holland. Holland only took those with very low quota numbers. They wanted to help us. The country was swollen with refugees, but they wanted us out again as quickly as possible. The entire ship went to Antwerp, Belgium, the whole ship. And I remember boarding a smaller ship, much smaller ship, and gliding along the Dutch coastline, which was very, very hilly. And looking up at the hills, to me, it looked like hundreds of Dutchmen were there. You know, the women with those pointed hats and a lot of guys with the wooden shoes, and they all seemed to be waving at us and clapping and cheering us on. It made me feel just a wee bit better. So we ended out in Rotterdam. And there we were placed in a detention camp called Rotterdam West. Now I'd be the first one to tell you, there is indeed a huge difference between a concentration camp and a detention camp. Nevertheless, the detention camp, at least ours, had a high barbed wire fence, had a guard at the gate, and you couldn't come in and out without permission. So then we were separated. Mom was placed, they call it an adult compound, and I was put in a children's compound. So I was pretty much separated from her. What I remember most about the camp is, one, I was always hungry. I don't want to imply that we weren't fed, it just wasn't enough. Second, it was a filthy camp. Most of us, we think of camp, we think of grass. There was no grass growing there. It was all dirt and lots of rocks. And finally, I was cold. We've now gone to October. We're still in the camp. Mom, each of us had one big suitcase. Mom packed mine with summer clothes. I don't think in her wildest dream did she anticipate, when she was supposed to go to Cuba, ending out in a detention camp in Holland, where it was cold. The camp was right by the Atlantic, right by the sea. I remember sitting on a high rock counting waves. I could have walked into the Atlantic. That's the whole surface of the winds hurling in from the sea were fierce. I got a severe eye infection, the rim of the eye, not the actual eye, which turned fiercely red because it wasn't being treated. So the two things I do remember is, one, something really nice happened at the camp. This one time, this huge truck from Joint came directly into the middle of our children's compound. And the truck opened up, the back opened up, and out spilled lots and lots and lots of children's clothing. So I remember I saw this little blue coat, which I grabbed. A little bit small for me, but it was warm. And I wore it during the day. It kept me warm. I wore it at night. It kept me warm. The other nice thing I remember is one day Mom came to the children's compound with a raw egg. I remember we went to the bathroom, she put on the hot water faucet. Needless to say, the hot water faucet, it never turned hot, it was lukewarm. Of course, the raw egg remained a raw egg. But you know what? It was delicious. Why? I was hungry. That's simple. In the meantime, legally, my father came from Cuba to Miami, and this is a telegraph he sends to my mother, simply to say, I arrived safely in Miami. I'm going to Washington to get the proper documents. Remember, our 2 months, the quota of everybody in the camp were up, and we could legally come to America. And after that, I'm going to Philly to get us a place to live. So Mom gets the documents, the proper documents, permission to leave the camp, goes to the American consulate in Rotterdam. And he tells her, there's no more ships leaving Holland for America. And his recommendation, according to my mother, were, you stay in the camp until the war's over. Now you understand the war didn't start, but somehow the adults seemed to know there was going to be one. And then after the war, then you travel to America. Somehow my mother didn't accept this. Today we'd call her an activist. And she went to the person in charge of the camp, and incidentally, the detention camp held a lot more people than just 189 from the St. Louis. It was filled with other refugees as well. So he was called the commander. And luckily for us, he was also the captain in the Dutch Navy. Now, she wanted to give him something before she saw him. And she discovered he was a stamp collector. Now, before we left Germany, and she was packing my suitcase, she said to me, you can take one item, whatever you want. You can have a book, toys, a doll, whatever you want, one item, and we'll pack it in a suitcase. And she left the decision up to me. And I thought real hard, what am I going to take that's important and leave everything else behind? And then it occurred to me to take the stamp collection. Why? Because my favorite Uncle Willie, who lived about a block from our house, came almost daily to see me. He saw I was very lonely. He also saw I was learning nothing. So he thought he'd educate me a little bit. So he started with me a stamp collection. He collected stamps, explained a little bit about geography and history so I would learn something. Together we'd put it in a stamp book. And that was my stamp collection. So I thought, I'll take that, because I just didn't know if I'd ever see him again. Mom comes to the children's compound and demands my stamp collection. And I told her no. I said, I could have taken a book. She said, but you didn't. And I said, and she's telling me this nice person, he was going to help us get out of this camp. We would go to America, where my father was waiting for us. And I'm thinking, if this is such a nice person, he'll help us without my stamp collection. And I wouldn't give it up. I wouldn't give it to her. So she left. one day, I'm playing. Now, we lived sort of, the children in, it was like a dormitory, one cot after another. And the suitcases were underneath the bed. I mean, there wasn't such a thing as a chest of drawers. I had found on the ground somewhere, looked sort of like an orange crate, and I put my belongings in there. I didn't have very much. And prominently displayed in there was, of course, my stamp collection. So one day, I came from playing outside back into the dorm, and I immediately noticed my stamp collection was gone. My mother had sneaked into the dorm while I'm playing outside and took it. That's exactly what she did, and gave it to the commander. Now he said to her, it's true, there aren't any more ships leaving Holland, but why don't you go to Antwerp? There's some ships going to the US from Antwerp, Belgium. Of course, she said yes, and we traveled from the detention camp to Antwerp, Belgium, and there we had a wonderful surprise. My aunt, my mom's younger sister, and her husband and son were there taking that same ship we were. Very, very briefly, Kristallnacht, my uncle Walter, was coming home from a business trip. And he told me this many years later, he hadn't even gone home to his wife. She didn't even know that he'd arrived. Two Germans, right off the street, she said, in street clothes, grabbed him, one on each arm, and put him into a truck where he said there were other Jewish men and teenage boys, and their destination, final destination, was Buchenwald. Now, what I want you kids to understand is that in 1939, if you had family outside of Germany, most of the inmates were able to get out. Now, my uncle had a big family in Luxembourg, and as soon as my aunt discovered that he had been taken to the Buchenwald concentration camp, she contacted his family, and they immediately sent the proper documents that he could be with them in Luxembourg. So after he arrived, she joined him, and together, after being half a year or so in Luxembourg, they went to Antwerp, having no idea that Mom and I were going to take the same ship to go to the United States. Now, there was an extra little perk in there for me because my aunt and uncle were in first class. We were in third class. So I remember every morning climbing very steep steps. The steps were steep probably because I was small, up to first class with my aunt and uncle. And that's where I had my meals. And they were good, and nobody bothered me. Meantime, as we're traveling to the USA, Mom's telling me, and by this time she's a nervous wreck, oh, you should be happy now, very happy, because soon we'll be with Dad. We're now going to America. Remember, I had this story before. We're now going to America, and you're going to be together with your dad. I didn't believe a word, but I was wise enough not to voice my opinion. I just nodded my head, but I didn't believe her. I didn't believe her until we arrived right here in New York Harbor. And I got off the ship, and there was my dad. And he swung me around and held me. Then I was happy. And I'm looking around, and I see all these people. And it looked to me like they're running in all directions. In Europe, everything is very leisurely paced, slow pace. So I asked my dad, what's going on? Where is everybody rushing to? And he just laughed, and he said, this is America. And yes, it is a wonderful country where we have our freedom. But all of us have to be cautious and vigilant so that we don't lose this precious gift called freedom. That's it. What happened to the captain? Because he really disobeyed the orders of the Nazi regime. He wouldn't go back, even though by now he's being threatened. Of course he lost his job. Yes, he lost his job and everything. He went back with the empty ship, that is with the staff. But he knew that, he knew, and he got another job. But here's the irony of that. They left him alone. Nothing happened to him. To me, the irony of the story is that when the German people were really suffering, you know, lots of bombing from the US and so forth during the war, it was a few passengers from the St. Louis, even though we had very little, that shared what we had with him after all he saved our lives. That's the irony of the story. And of course, later on, he was declared, even by the German government, who was looking very hard to find a few heroes among their ranks as a hero. But they just left him alone when he came back. My theory always was, there were so few, unfortunately, that didn't obey the orders of the Nazi regime, that they didn't bother with the few. I would say that the St. Louis was a good pivot point, because here was a ship with almost 1,000 people on it. And where was the United States? All of us could have legally come 2-3 months later. And you know, Ellis Island was still open in 1939. So that's an example for the rest of the world to take. So that's right there. I mean, they weren't stupid, the Germans. They saw what was happening around the world. They didn't expect that. And I think one of the biggest difficulties was that they couldn't go to Palestine, which was my dad's dream. And I know of many others my dad's age who said exactly the same thing. They wanted to build up Palestine, a Jewish state, before it became the state of Israel. And that was cut off right from under there. Did anybody say anything, do anything, stop it? No. The destination of where the Jewish people went was of no interest to the German government. They really wanted to rid Germany of the Jews. That was really what Hitler's intent was. They wanted to make Germany, German word is Judenrein, free it of the Jewish people. They were perfectly content if the Jews left to go elsewhere. The problems were that there were difficulties, Jews leaving. Palestine was not, if Israel had been there at that point, they would have all gone to, we would have all gone to Israel. It was still Palestine. And then the English passed what is called the White Paper, because that's where my dad wanted to bring us, and Jews were not allowed to go to Palestine, and that was a big thing when they cut them out. And you heard what happened to those from other ships in the St. Louis, they were turned back, so that was the problem. So that this was only in 39, things got worse later. So they were happy when the inmates of that prison, as they called the concentration camp, had a place to go. Luckily for my uncle, he had a family outside of Germany that he could go to. Not everybody was that fortunate. What happened to the other passengers? Of course, everyone, as I said, that went to England was saved. In Holland, I don't really know, I understand that some were saved in different countries. I only know pretty much about Holland because that's where I was. And I know that a couple of weeks after we left, the people, the rest of the people, were moved to the Westerbork detention, once the Nazis came in, it was a concentration camp. And Frank, if you know her story, that's where she went to. And I traced what happened to them because they were my friends. You know, I had bonded with a few of the girls that I had slept with in the same room. So that's where they went to, the Westerbork, which was the camp was actually paid for by the Jewish community in Holland and the government in Holland. It was going, when I said it was really an awful camp where we were, Rotterdam West, I'm not exaggerating. And the government, the Dutch government agreed. And that's why they built this bigger camp. Unfortunately, when the Nazis came into Holland, it was perfect for them and they took over. They took out the person in charge of the camp. They took him out immediately and they put in an SS, they put in a German officer, and everything changed. And I got to see it years later. My husband took me there. I just wanted to see it because that's where my friends went. I saw the railroad tracks. It was not a death camp. But what happened is when they had too many people there, how they got rid of them? They put them on the trains. And on the trains, the destination was Auschwitz and some of the other death camps. So that's how you get rid of people when you have too many. You just put them on the train, then comes in a new batch. That's how they operated. Why was it a luxurious ship? Well, because remember back in 1939, it's a business. So they knew the Jews. One of the reasons they went to Cuba was Cuba was still allowing us in from Germany. Now remember, my father went to Cuba. He had no problem whatsoever. He didn't go alone. He went on a ship with others, not that many, but others. So it was a money thing. Believe me when I tell you, this was not cheap. If you were on the lowest socioeconomic ladder and you were Jewish, and there were plenty of Jews that weren't well-to-do, that's how you got stuck. And everything took money. Everything took money. There's no question about it. And that was a very expensive passage. And we had to pay for a return passage, which is ridiculous, just more money. It was all about money. And this company was making money on the passengers. Whether I had been in touch with, that's often asked of me, with any of my former friends as a kid. A, I had no more former friends, you know, because everyone, I was like totally boycotted. I mean, my former friends played across the street from me and I was like invisible. It's not like anybody threw stones at me. I was just not there, totally ignored. So I had no friends. Mariana, I never saw her again. And at one point, I never wanted to go back to Germany, but my husband also is a survivor and came from Düsseldorf. And he had a trip. He went back and many years later. And at that point, he said to me, I'm going back with or without you, you know. And the alternative. So I said, well, if you promise to take me to Holland and I can go to Westerberg, I'll go with you to Düsseldorf. So that's in. My daughter wrote to them in Kirchheim, and that's how they found out. And you know, we went back. And when we got back to Kirchheim, we met with the mayor of the town, all of the things I didn't want to do. And the only thing I asked for was her, Mariana. Nobody had ever heard of her. Who? What? No, we never, you know, like she didn't exist. So I don't know whatever happened to her. I'd like to know. I hope she was well. It certainly wasn't her fault. But I point that story out to show you the attitude of the average German. It wasn't the government who said, don't you ever play with this other child. It was the father who said, you can't play with her. You know, I mean, that's my point, the attitude of the German public.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double high or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM. To JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive on DVD with our compliments. and we thank you for your kind support.